narrowly true. I've always been very fond of the word foreign. It gives off a sense of mystery and a sense of intrigue, and connotes a glorious period between Magellan and Tom Friedman, when the world was round, boat, lots of rough edges and dangerous places, not flat and level and one-dimensional, as some people would have us believe. And foreign is a much more versatile word, particularly here in America. It can be used to describe an object stuck in your esophagus, or as a trigger for parochialism and the xenophobia that still is very evident in our young country. I particularly like the word foreign when it's joined with the words news or correspondent, because it dresses them up with romance and purpose, which is the reporting on and from a country other than your own. I did not enter journalism to be an international reporter. I entered journalism to be a foreign correspondent. And it's a job that requires you not only to understand the facts of the story that you're reporting, but the context and the history behind it, the cultures involved, the politics, the phobias, and the passions of the place and the people that you're reporting on. I was bitten with the bug back in 1970, when I was shortly after I was drafted into the U.S. Army, and I was able to leverage some journalism courses that I'd taken at Syracuse, and my work on the campus newspaper into a job eventually when I got sent to Vietnam with the 25th Infantry Division in Cu Chi. And one of my jobs was to escort network camera people and representatives of the New York Times and the Washington Post and the LA Times, mostly television camera crews and their correspondents, out in the field. And one day, a group came in from CBS, and I took them up to War Zone C. And from that point on, at age 23, I knew exactly what it was I wanted to do. I wanted to be a network television correspondent, and I dedicated every move from that point on to try and achieve that job. And a few months later, I had an opportunity to go to Stars and Stripes, which was sort of a real journalism job, and something that I could put on my resume. And I was working mostly alongside other reporters who had been drafted out of the Washington Post or the New York Times and the LA Times. So it was a real terrific experience for me, and I enjoyed it so much. I had to travel all over the country, and I enjoyed it so much I thought about staying and trying to get on as a radio stringer with one of the radio networks, until my parents and a few other people advised me that I was out of my mind and it was time for me to come home. I spent another 10 years trying to fulfill my dream. As been mentioned, one of them at Columbia. And finally, in my second year at CBS, I got my first big assignment, which was to cover the 1982 elections in El Salvador, which is in itself a sort of a strange story, because CBS, for one of the few times in my whole career, had more reporters in El Salvador to cover that election than any of the other networks, probably combined. Specials out of there, and I was trying to figure out why. And then somebody told me that they were having CBS Records was having some dispute with the Salvadoran government, and they had frozen CBS's ability to move the money out of the country. So they just decided to send the news division down there to spend it. Well, financial thing, all this I'm sure some of you know. Anyway, I was dispatched in El Salvador. And we stayed at this little hotel in the center of town. And there were mountains behind us where the gorillas stayed. And there was an army garrison in front of the hotel, sort of a little Central American square. And that next morning at dawn, election day, the fighters came. And we were right in the middle of the crossfire. And the battle raged for 3 days. About noon of that election day, I got a call. We wound the phone underneath the telephone under this table. And it was somebody from CBS Radio wanting to do a story. They had gone to a story on the radio about the huge turnout that was taking place in Jerusalem. And I had informed the radio desk that nobody was going to be in this room. And they were very skeptical. It was right here on the Associated Press. So I said, well, Tony, his name is Tony, I said, I'm going to do this big oak desk. I'm going to hold the phone up so you can hear the bullets going around. Next to me is the election commissioner, and he has not opened a single polling place, so I guarantee you that there is nobody voting in this room. And if the AP says that, and the South Korean government says that, we've got a pretty good story. And it ratified in my mind two things that I had long suspected and that were that I had been nurturing in my mind and have been confirmed many times since then. The first one is that all governments lie at one time or another. And the second is that if you're a foreign correspondent on the road, the Home Office in New York or London or wherever it is you work to, won't know what the hell's going on, and I have absolutely no idea of what you have to go through in order to file your story. And after that, I was rewarded with another assignment from London, which was the highlight and the happiest time of my career at CBS, which is now, I think, 33 years. I always considered myself, particularly on a foreign assignment, as not just a journalist, but also as a translator, an interpreter, trying to explain what was going on in the foreign country that I was in, that most Americans probably couldn't even find on a map, and to explain why it was important to them and what effect it might have, or to at least tell them something that they didn't know about that country and that situation. And I guess I grew the thought that the job may not be as exciting now as it used to be. I can remember walking through the CBS newsroom when I first came there in 1980 and 81, and went, used to go right by the foreign desk every day. And CBS had bureaus all over the world. And you would always see somebody in the phone. It was the loudest place to be in, one or two phones. Oh, Cairo! Cairo! Cairo!